Hi, I'm Lyubo. I'm a quantitative researcher at Susquehanna. I've been here for about 6 years at this point. Throughout my time here, I've interviewed probably hundreds of quant candidates. And so I wanted to make kind of a short video talking about a lot of the questions that I commonly face during interviews, questions like, you know, what is a quant? What do quants do on a day-to-day basis? What has my experience been? What kind of skills do I think are needed for the job? And so, you know, a lot of what I'm gonna say are really things that I wish I knew when I started. So hopefully by the time you finish this video, you should know more than I did. So starting with kind of the main question, what is a quant? I should point out that quant is generally an umbrella term. As I said, my role is a quantitative researcher. And really, I don't think of a quant so much as a role, but rather as, again, this umbrella term that covers the type of things that you do. So what do quants do? The short answer is we're responsible for building mathematical frameworks to understand the financial world, specifically data, open markets, and use that understanding to then impact directly or indirectly actual decision-making or trading. There are a few things I need to unpack here. What do we mean by mathematical framework and formalism? Right, so obviously we see this empirical data, real-world behavior, and then we're trying to encode it in some way in this mathematical formalism. A good example is the notion of a fair price, right? We have perhaps a stock, and we want to know, well, what is the fair price, right? So there is kind of a sense that that's a useful concept to understand, but at the same time, no one quite tells us that. You observe perhaps trades in the market, people trade at various prices. It's also unclear when you say fair price, do you mean the fair price that I think, or is it some cumulative notion of market fair price? Is that fair price right now, or am I referring to some point in the future, right? So I can even have sort of multiple different definitions of what it is. But kind of the main point is it's a concept that I need to create a mathematical framework for that doesn't quite exist in you know, in the world. And so you can certainly say, well, the fair price could just be the last traded price, right? And sure, that's going to be close enough, but you can think, well, just because two parties kind of agreed to trade there doesn't really represent any notion of where everyone else agrees. And so, okay, so maybe I want to take the last 10 trades, average them up. And so in some ways that's going to be better, perhaps less noisy. But then at the same time, you're already kind of going 10 trades in the past. Since then, things might have changed. And so 10 trades ago is maybe not very accurate representation of where things are right now. And you can kind of see how you can sort of keep stacking those things up. And of course, it's not just the fair price. There are all sorts of ways in which we, again, try to encode information, create definitions, create some sort of rigorous mathematical framework to understand the world. The next piece I need to talk about is, of course, the context in which all of this is happening. And that context are the financial markets, And specifically data, right? And data comes in a lot of different forms. We have the you know, exchange data, which represents the behavior of everyone, all the trades that are happening. What are we doing? What is everyone else doing? It's data that continuously streams at, you know, and changes at sort of a fraction of a microsecond. There is, of course, data that's more irregular, even maybe release once a day or once in a while, any sort of financial data. Now that we have this data, we have a mathematical framework to understand it. And all of this is supposed to often culminate in a single decision, right? We have some kind of an opportunity to trade in the market. Do we want to take it or not, right? Or I could even say, is the price of some underlying going to go up or down? Right, and so a lot of these kind of come down to just simple binary decisions. So we often think about the kind of the system that we're trying to build as a lot of data is coming in, right, of all sorts. Now we need to take it, perform some kind of operation on it, systematize it, understand it, and it essentially sort of compress it in this chain or in this network. And again, at the end, we need to make sort of singular decisions. And so quants can sort of operate at the very early part of that chain. They can operate more towards the end, which is kind of more where trading happens. But wherever you are, kind of any one input you have would certainly, you know, propagate downstream and could be very impactful, even if it's kind of happening earlier in the process. So another question I wanted to touch upon was, what are the skills that a quant needs to possess? And so certainly there's some soft skills, things like working hard, or communicating your ideas well, being driven, etc. But I more wanted to touch upon what are kind of the different fields that I see being related to being a quant. And so those would be math and stats, computer science, machine learning, finance, data science, game theory. And the important thing to point out is that based on the project that you're working on, each one of those pieces could have a different degree of importance. So there are actually quants who operate more as machine learning experts, right? They might just be mostly, they might care about the latest machine learning developments and always be on the lookout and curious if they can kind of find something and find an edge there and use something new. Maybe they work on deep learning infrastructure. And then at the same time, they might not be very well versed in exchange microstructure. They might not know much about strategies. On the other hand, there are quants who operate kind of more on that strategy side, more on the trading side. They are very much aware of playing that game of imperfect information with other people in the markets and sort of exceeding in that space. Their quants cooperate more on the computer science, on development side of things. They have a very in-depth understanding of the actual infrastructure that supports our systems and supports trading. And so a lot of their work could be more of a development work, but they still serve as a quant and fall under that general umbrella. There are even people who are more of a generalist. You know, at some point our system can become kind of so big that it almost becomes its own field of study. And so you can come in, and of course, again, we are trying to map the real world and encode it in these mathematical frameworks. But then once it's become big enough, you kind of want to actually understand how that thing in and of itself operates and sort of often serve as a bridge between different groups, right? Because obviously, what kind of quants build and what they do, it doesn't exist in isolation. It's kind of all connected. And certainly there are cases where you find like there's this one little module and this group of quants works over here, and then there's another group over there, and they're not very well synced up. And then once they sync up, we can sort of reorganize the system and be sort of gain efficiency this way. Perhaps a subject I'll pay special attention to is data science. Data science, of course, having the word science in there, it indicates that it's a rigorous subject that follows the scientific method. But at the same time, in my experience, it's also somewhat of an art form. You know, you're trying to find some kind of a pattern. How do you know that you are taking into account all of the other variables, right? How do you know you have the domain expertise to isolate the signal from the noise? Even sometimes, when do you know to doubt your data? So there are a lot of kind of lessons there. As one example, something that my manager told me when I was first starting, and I take it as a, it served me well throughout my time here, has been the idea that you always want to make sure that, let's say you have two variables, X and Y, you want to understand the relationship between them. You plot them out, and you see some kind of a pattern. Before you actually observe the pattern, you want to build an idea of what you expect to see. And then one of two things can happen. It's either going to match reality, and then you know that your toy model of how the world works is correct, or it's not. And cases where it's not, you kind of always need to take a step back and sort of figure out why and what's missing. And so this process is kind of constantly ongoing. It's, you know, it's very hard to provide a sort of a recipe or a textbook, and you know, then your data work just ends up being this step by step by step, right? You often have to be critical on every step, be nimble, be willing to adjust. What you produce can end up being this very rigorous and very sort of robust framework, but at the same time, if you over-focus on that, you can very easily not be kind of flexible enough and adjust to the real world, right? Because at the end of the day, we are trying to model something that almost implicitly we know we can't, right? We can get close to the truth empirically, but we can never quite get there. So that flexibility is important, and in a sense, then there is this balance between sort of rigor, being systematic, but also being practical, and in sort of towing that line, I find to be, you know, there is a lot of space for creativity, and I think it's what makes the job very exciting. On a related note, I also wanted to talk a little bit about the notion of backtesting. Often in our work, we need to figure out, okay, I have some idea of how to make our system better, right? I have some parameter that I can tune that I perhaps think will improve things, or I have some entirely different module or you know, wisdom that I've gained about how the world operates that I want to plug in the system. And I want to know, is it going to make things better? Right? Now, well, the only way to find out is to try it. But of course, we want to have a way to answer that question in advance, if we could. And so ideally, what you would do is you would say, well, I'm going to go back maybe a year ago, and I'm just going to compare my system back then to my system back now. I'm going to run my system as though as it was operating in real time and see what different decisions would I make, right? For some opportunity that I traded back then, maybe now I want to skip and vice versa, right? And then ideally then on the margins, you would be able to figure it out. You can sort of become very sophisticated in your backtesting capabilities and try to get pretty close to answering that question. But at the same time, I've been on the equity options desk at Susquehanna for the last 6 years. And, you know, we're in a situation where we are well into the double digits in terms of volume, percentage volume in the market. And so when you're that big, it's pretty much impossible to know what would happen when you change your behavior, because of course, when you change your behavior, so would everyone else. So knowing the state of the world back then is not enough, right? You have to make a few more assumptions about the first and second and third degree effects of you actually changing your behavior. And so it becomes this, you know, kind of very interesting, sort of infinitely deep problem that you're trying to figure out. And of course, what assumptions are you making? Do you need to push your backtest capabilities to the limits? Or maybe they suffice for whatever application you're looking for, right? And all of this, you can sort of start to see how there is a lot of space there for, as I mentioned, for creativity, a lot of space there to make the right assumptions. I also wanted to touch on what other roles are there, right? And I think to understand the quant role well, you also have to understand the broader context in which it operates. And again, I want to emphasize here that I don't like to think of those things as sort of like roles. They're not really fixed. I like to think of them more as certain, let's say, types of work that you do, right? So quants provide the blueprint of how we think we should be operating and how the markets operate. Developers then are responsible for actually bringing that blueprint to life. They provide the infrastructure, right? And there are a lot of exciting and complex questions there, both on the hardware and the software side. Traders are responsible for essentially overseeing how the system operates. They're sort of the drivers. They you know, sit at the very tail end of that decision-making process. And while ideally, you know, the system kind of operates on its own and makes decisions on its own, depending on what's actually happening, certainly depending on the asset class you're trading, traders can have more limited impact or a much, much greater impact. Another question I also often get is, what is the day-to-day life of a quant? You know, what kind of projects do quants do? And hopefully by now, you kind of understand why that question is a little hard to answer. You know, often in the past I've had multiple projects going on at the same time with very, very different flavors. You can go and ask, you know, all the 100 plus quants in the building right now, what all of these questions, what is their day-to-day life? And you can get pretty much 100 different answers, right? And again, to me, that's kind of the thing that keeps the job interesting. It makes the job exciting. We have to wear many hats. Our roles are very fluid, and ultimately, you know, we try to position ourselves in a way that lean on the skills we have and it would maximize our impact. So that's all for me. I hope you find this video useful. Please leave comments in the comment section. Maybe some things that you would like us to talk about more in the future. And good luck on your quant journey.